As I just mentioned, today we begin a new sermon series that we're simply calling Disconnect. And this will be a three-part sermon series. And over the course of these next 3 weeks, we will be looking at a few specific scripture passages. And the reason we're calling this series Disconnect is because these are passages that we hear about in church, passages that we may read during a Bible study or in a personal Bible study time. We learn these Bible passages, we see them, we believe them to be true, we think that they're important, and then we leave the church setting, we leave the Bible study, we close our Bibles, and it's as if we forgot what we just read. And it was so true to us in the moment, it was so important to us in the moment, but then, like I said, we close the Bible, we go about our daily lives, and it's just like you lose track of that passage. And this is something that I know I've personally done. You know, I'm just studying the Bible for myself, or I'm in a church service, and I hear some piece of wisdom, and I hear God's word, and it's not just like I actually like feel like I understand. I have some kind of an epiphany over it, and it's wonderful. I'm like, wow, God is so brilliant. God's so wonderful. I'm so glad that we have the Bible. I'm so glad that I've had teachers to explain these things to me. And then I leave the church building, and I forget to live that truth out. I forget to access that wisdom over the course of my day-to-day life. And I know I'm not the only one who does that. I think we all do that from time to time. And I hope that you've all had that experience where you hear the word of God and it clicks with you and you understand what God was communicating. But sometimes, like I said, we lose track of that wisdom. We forget about it. And maybe it's just that simple. We forget. We're forgetful people. Or maybe it's just that we're too busy and we go on to the next thing and then we're on to the next thing and we're on to the next thing. And it's like, well, I forgot whatever we talked about Sunday. I can't remember. Several of you were here last week. How many of you remember what we talked about last Sunday? Don't raise your hand. That'd be embarrassing. But we lose track. We forget these things. If we're not living them out in our day-to-day lives, if we're not reminding ourselves, if we're not going to God in prayer, we can just receive this wisdom and lose it. So that's what we're talking about over the course of these next 3 weeks. Three Bible passages that, you know, if you're a Christian, if you've been in the church before, you probably have heard these passages before. You may have even memorized some of these verses before. But these are passages, these are pieces of wisdom from God that we tend to lose track of in our lives. Now today, Holly read for us just a fantastic passage from 2 Corinthians. And as she was reading, I'm thinking about all the, like, this is just, it's loaded with fantastic information here, important things that Paul, the writer of the book, is communicating. Now, Paul originally wrote this. It was a letter. He wrote it to the church of Corinth. And the church in Corinth, they had a lot of problems. They had a lot of issues there. And Paul wrote to them trying to really get them back on the right track. And he shares just brilliant, brilliant wisdom. And I wish we had time for me to go through every single verse of this. It's so fantastic. I mean, look at 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. Did you ever hear that? I mean, that's wonderful. It's a wonderful truth. And I know, you know, back when I was a children's pastor at our last church, we had a Bible memorization club called Awana. And we used to teach the kids that verse. And we used to go over that verse all the time. Because that's so important to know that once you receive Jesus, you're something new. And the old is gone and the new has come. That's a fantastic, fantastic verse. And all that Paul is telling us about the ministry of reconciliation. This is why Jesus came to the world to reconcile God and man, to restore a relationship there. And then Jesus hands us over this work, the ministry of reconciliation. That's huge. That's vital to what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ that God has given us, that Jesus has handed off to us this ministry of reconciliation. But for our purposes today, I want to focus in on what it says here in verse 20. Here Paul tells us, we the followers of Jesus, we the people who call ourselves Christians, we are therefore Christ's ambassadors. We are Christ's ambassadors. Now, I have a personal response when I read these words. I like part of this. Part of what Paul is telling me, I like. Because I like that Paul is telling me and telling us that we are not Christ's salesmen. Right? That's not what we are. That's not what we're about. We're not in the world trying to sell Jesus, you know, trying to convince people of something that seems a little bit manipulative. The last church I worked for, we had a lot of our church leaders were also leaders in the business world, which was a fantastic thing to be able to learn from their, you know, their wisdom and their knowledge and their experience. But we did have salespeople in these church leadership positions. And it always make my skin crawl just a little bit to hear them use sales tactics to try to share Jesus with people. And I don't want to be judgmental of that. I'm just saying that's not quite it. We are not called to be salesmen and women for Jesus Christ. But we are called to something bigger than that. We're called to be his ambassadors. And so, like I said, part of me likes what Paul is saying because I don't want to be Christ's salesman. But to be an ambassador, that's overwhelming. Isn't it? To be an ambassador of Jesus Christ? And you know what it is to be an ambassador? When you're an ambassador, you represent someone else. You represent a group of people. You're out there in the world, and it's your job not just to share your own thoughts and to share your opinion, but you are representing someone or something else. You're the ambassador. Now, show of hands, who feels qualified to be an ambassador of Jesus Christ? The Son of God, the Savior of the world. Anybody say, yeah, I can pull that off. I can be his ambassador, no problem, sign me up. I mean, that's a huge, huge responsibility to be the ambassador of Jesus Christ in this world. Now, recently, you know, I shared a lot about this last Sunday. Recently, I was in Kenya on a missions trip, and while we were there, all of us, to some degree, felt this burden of we are ambassadors, not just of the church, but we are ambassadors of the United States of America. We were. Now, nobody officially sanctioned us before we left the United States. Nobody said, you know, I hereby decree you are now ambassadors of America. But that's just how it works by default. And we were told, you know, while we're there, if, you know, if we're in a public setting or if some one of the Kenyan people, if they invite us into their home, if they want to share food with us, eat with them. Because if you don't eat with them, it's very rude. They're going to think you're just another American snob who's too good for their lowly food. So it means a lot to them. Share meals with them. And we did just that. In fact, we had a Sunday where we all worshiped together. And after the worship service, they served a meal, a very fine meal that took them a long time to make. Not food that I was used to eating, not food that we're used to eating here in America. But then they insisted that the guests from America eat first. And we're thinking, oh my goodness, so many of the people here are hungry and don't have food on a regular basis. And you know, our instinct was to say, no, you guys eat. But that would have been rude. And so we ate that food. And even though, you know, maybe it wasn't what we would have chosen to eat, we ate it because we wanted to show we're not rude American snob people, okay? We were ambassadors of Jesus Christ, first and foremost, but we're also representatives of the United States of America. And like I said, that wasn't something, nobody officially sanctioned us. It's just, it's what happened by default. And what Paul is talking about here, what he writes about here, is similar, okay? Now, you may not feel qualified to be a representative of the Son of God, a representative of the Savior of the world, but it's just what happens. When people find out that you are a Christian, when people find out that you're a church-going person, they're going to look at your life, they're going to listen to your words, they're going to see the things that you do, and they're going to associate you with Jesus. You didn't sign up for that. I didn't sign up for that. That's just what happens. And it's not as if Jesus has sentenced us to this thing. You have to be my ambassador. It's just, it's what happens. People listen to what we say. They look at what we do. And if they know that we're Christians, if we know that we're followers of Jesus, if they know that, they automatically are going to make that kind of a connection. Now, let me go back and just try to broaden our horizons a little bit about what it means to be an ambassador and how big of a deal that is. Let's say that you were an official ambassador of the United States of America. And let's say you go and visit, North Korea. And let's say that while you're there, You forget that you're an ambassador. You forget that you're representing somebody else. And you just start sharing your own opinions and your own thoughts. And maybe your thoughts aren't great. And maybe your opinions are rude or controversial or just disrespectful. Then all of a sudden, the people that are there with you, they don't realize that you have stopped being an ambassador. You see what I'm saying? They're listening to what you're saying, and they're associating what you're saying with what it means to be an American. And so they get upset with us, and they go to war with us, right? Okay? I mean, I'm just trying to give you a dramatic example of what this can be like. And so for us, if we're out there in the world and people know that we're Christians, and people see what we're doing, people are either going to have one of two responses to that. They're going to see the way that we live. They're going to hear the words that we speak. They're going to see the way that we treat our children, the way that we treat our parents, the way that we treat our neighbors, the way that we treat our spouses. And they're either going to say, wow, I respect that. I appreciate that. And if that's what it means to be a follower of Jesus, then hey, maybe that's a good thing after all. You know, maybe it's good to be a Christian. Maybe I'll go check out church. I don't know. Maybe it's worth investigating at least. Or they're going to see the way we live, hear the words we use, look at how we behave in the world, and they're going to say, if that's what it means to be a follower of Jesus, then I am not interested. I don't want any part of that. Right? Now, when I was younger, now, there was a time in my life where I didn't really feel, you know, I went to church, but I didn't really feel like a part of the Christian circle, so to speak. I felt like I was outside of the Christian bubble. And I was still trying to, you know, when you're young, you're weighing things out and you're trying to develop, an opinion of your own. You've been raised by your parents and then you're trying to figure out, well, what did they teach me? Was this true? Or you know, just trying to figure out things for yourself. And I remember during that phase of my life, watching Christians, listening to them, seeing how they treated one another, experiencing how they treated me. And there were plenty of Christians that made me feel like, I don't want to be a part of that. If that's what it means to be a Christian, I don't want to be a part of it. And if you're representing Jesus, then I don't know about Jesus. That's maybe some of you have had a similar experience where you've been on the outside and you're looking in and you're like, if I had to figure out who Jesus is based on your behavior, then I'm not sure that I want anything to do with him. See, that's an unfortunate thing. And now we're calling this series Disconnect because we can talk about this stuff in this setting. We can talk about this for about 20, 25 minutes, and then you can all go home and forget about it. But I don't want you to forget about it. I don't want me to forget about it. I don't want us to disconnect from the reality that wherever we go and whatever we do and whatever we post on Facebook, we are still ambassadors of Jesus Christ. Nowadays, I am a Christian. Yes? I am a part of the church. I do see myself as part of the body of Christ. I do see myself in that way. And so when I'm on Facebook and I see my Christian friends post things that are, maybe off-color jokes or off-color cartoons, or when I read that my Christian friends are using, foul language on Facebook, or when I see them using Facebook to rant about their coworkers or somebody who cut them off in traffic or all that stuff. At this point, I am able to realize, okay, those people aren't truly representing Jesus. I know that now. I understand that now. But if I wasn't a Christian and I saw my Christian friends and, I'm not picking on people who are on Facebook. I'm on Facebook. We're on Facebook, okay? But if I see them using Facebook in a certain way, like, I know better, but what if I wasn't a Christian? Say, look at the kind of off-color humor they're using here. Look at the language they're using. Look at, what is this post even saying? I got complaints, I got rants, I got, what is this? See, this is one of these, and I'm bringing up Facebook as an example because this is a classic case of how we disconnect from the reality that we are ambassadors of Jesus Christ. If we're ambassadors of Jesus Christ, then why is it okay for us to go on Facebook and use foul language? Why is it okay for us to do that? It's not. All right, and we have to really pause and, think about the fact that whether we like it or not, whether we're comfortable with it or not, whether we feel like we're qualified or not, we are Christ's ambassadors. Or people are going to look at what we say, look at how we behave, look at how we are in real life, look at what we're posting on Facebook, and they're going to make certain connections between who we are and who Jesus is. Wow. Do you feel that burden? Oh boy, wow. Now, I want to kind of counterbalance this with the fact that Jesus has promised to us, promised to all of his followers, that he has given us the Holy Spirit to dwell among us and within us. And I believe that the only way that we can truly be ambassadors of Jesus Christ is by relying on the Holy Spirit to guide us, to give us words to speak, to give us direction, to say, you know, don't say that, don't do this, don't post that status update, whatever it may be. Let me give you a personal example. I don't want to pick on you. I'll pick on myself a little bit, okay? Let me give you a little bit of a glimpse into my life. So most of you know this about me, all right? I'm a fan of Batman. Did you know that about me? Several of you did, okay? Like the Batman books, the Batman comics, the Batman movies. Christopher Nolan's a genius. Dark Knight trilogy, fantastic. And so I love all that kind of stuff. And if you go on my Facebook page, you'll probably see little glimpses of that in my life. Well, I found out recently that they're making a new Batman movie, actually a Superman Batman movie, and I thought, well, that's not a great idea, but you know what? No one consulted me before deciding that they were going to make it. So they're going to make this movie. And then I found out a few days ago that Ben Affleck, the actor, is going to be the next Batman. Again, nobody consulted me before making that decision. If they had, I would have said, maybe try somebody else. Now, I do not know Mr. Affleck personally. It's not like we hang out or not like we're friends, but I'm not a fan of his work as an actor. And so when I heard this news, what I wanted to do is just post something on Facebook and say, you know what, guess who's the new Batman? Probably not a great idea. All right, something simple like that. Now, there would have been nothing wrong with me doing that, right? I mean, you can express your opinions. There's nothing wrong with that. However, I was also in the midst of preparing this series and thinking about being an ambassador of Jesus Christ. And I was wondering, you know, if someone saw me post something that seems negative about another human being, would they look at that statement and think, is that what it means to be a Christian? So it's stuff like that. Now, for those of you who are on Facebook, I know not everybody is. I was very late to the game on Facebook. I didn't want to be on Facebook because I have a past, all right? And I've got people in my past, and I don't want them to find me, okay? That's just truth, all right? But I finally did get on Facebook because I think it's a great way to keep in touch with people and really promote what we're doing as a church and share information about that. But I'm not picking on you if you're on Facebook. And I know some Christians and some pastors and some people use Facebook to, like, post a verse of the day, or they share a video link to a sermon, you know, that they've heard or whatever it is. That's great. That's really cool. I don't do that. I don't do like a verse of the day on Facebook. I could. I prefer not to do that just because I always like the opportunity to be able to talk about the verse and talk about the Bible passage other than just throwing it out there. But it's fine if people want to do that. That's all well and good. I'm not saying that you have to shut down your Facebook account unless you're putting Bible passages up there every day. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just asking you to remember in real life and in your Facebook world, and when you're with your family, and when you're with your neighbors, and when you're with your spouse, and when you're, you know, disciplining your children, and all these arenas of life, you are an ambassador of Jesus Christ. And whether you realize it or not, people are watching. People are listening. Now, here's something that you will probably never experience. You'll probably never have somebody come up to you and say, you know what? I know that you're a Christian. I've been watching your behavior. I've been listening to the way you speak. I've been watching the way you treat other people. And you have convinced me that I don't want to be a Christian. Even if somebody feels that way, they're probably not going to say that to you. And frankly, I wish more people would say that because I think that would open our eyes. Again, I'm not picking on you. We all need to think about this. We all need to work on this. But how wonderful would it be to have somebody say to us, have somebody say to you, I wasn't interested in any kind of organized religion kind of thing. I had a bad experience with the church when I was a kid, but I've been watching you, and I've been listening to the words you use, and I've been experiencing the love that you have. And you have convinced me that Jesus is at least worth checking out. And I might even go to church. Wouldn't that be wonderful to hear? I hope that all of you get to experience that sometime in your life. For somebody to say to you, you're a Christian and I appreciate what you're doing. So maybe that's what I want to be too. I don't know. Can I come with you to church on Sunday?
Yeah, sure, I guess.
You know, wouldn't that be wonderful to experience that? And this is what we need to think about collectively as a church. Some of you who are here this morning, you see yourselves as a part of this church. You think of yourselves as members of the church. And by the way, that's our membership requirement, the desire to be a part of this. If you desire to be a part of what we're doing, you are a member. You are one of us. And so as a church, we need to think about how we represent Jesus first and foremost. But secondarily, we need to know that we're also ambassadors of Hope Community Church. You know, people find out we're a part of Hope, and they're going to associate what we do with the church as a whole. You know, we've been able to do some really fun service projects, some cool service projects together. We did a project where we went to some local laundromats and we wore our Hope shirts and we just paid for people to have their laundry done, just a simple way to serve our community and let people know that Jesus loves them. And when we do things like that, that projects a very positive image, doesn't it, of what it means to be a church. Or over the 4th of July when we helped with the Prospect Park events going on over there in Park Square and just wore our shirts. And how many people came up to us and said, wow, it's so great that you're doing this. You know, things like that we can do collectively to really give Jesus, first and foremost, a good name. He deserves it. He has a great, his name is holy. We've been called to be his ambassadors. So remember that if you consider yourself a part of Hope Community Church, you're not just representing Jesus. Yes, that's first and foremost. That's heads above everything else. That's most important, but you're also a representative of Hope Community Church. Now, going back to Facebook, what I love to see on Facebook is friends of Hope Community Church posting links to our events. Hey, we're starting a new sermon series. Hey, we're doing this service project. Hey, check out this, you know, video clip of our crazy preacher. He's so funny, or whatever it is. I don't know. I like seeing that, all right, because we can use social media. We can use YouTube and Facebook and all that to actually advance the kingdom, so to speak. We can use it to be positive examples of what it means to be a follower of Jesus. You know, a little bit earlier this morning, I took the time to talk you through what was on the back of your bulletin, and it was a longer announcement period because I wanted to let you know about what we're doing as a church. And we're going to be posting this stuff on our website. We're going to be posting this information on our Facebook page. And wouldn't it be great if everybody here who is on Facebook or everybody who has email just sent out email links, sent out Facebook messages, hey, look what we're doing as a church. That's something positive that you could do in your life. And that's something positive you could do to be a true ambassador of Jesus Christ. But it's not about Hope Community Church ultimately. It's about Jesus. And how wonderful it would be to have somebody say to you, I watched you. I looked at your life. You made me curious about Jesus, so I went to church. And when I was there, I met the Savior of humankind. I met Jesus, and I have received him as my personal Savior. And now I have the gift of eternal life, and it's because of you. And you played a large part in that just by being his ambassador. Now, you may not hear those words verbatim, but it's a wonderful thing to be able to have somebody tell you, you played a role in helping me find Jesus and helping me find salvation and helping me find eternal life. So let's go with this, okay? We're Christ's ambassadors. We may not feel qualified. We don't feel qualified. We're not qualified. But you know what? We have the Holy Spirit. So let's enjoy being Christ's ambassadors. Let's just like go 100% with it. And be out there in our day-to-day lives, not disconnected from this reality, but embracing this reality. In every conversation we have, think about, yep, I'm representing Jesus. And every time we get behind the wheel of a car, okay, I'm here and I'm representing Jesus. Every time we interact with our spouse or our children or our parents, okay, I'm representing Jesus. To go with it. And when we do that, we can have such a positive effect on our immediate surroundings and on our greater community. And that's the kind of thing we want to see happen right here in Delaware County. We want to see so many people, so many Hope people, and so many other Christians in the area just embracing the fact that we're ambassadors, that our light will shine and people will see that light and to be able to see the source behind it, Jesus Christ. So let's be his ambassadors. Let's enjoy being his ambassadors. Let's shine the way to Jesus.